Yes, I love you.
You will pass me because I don't look like a dog.
but I'll just be sitting, observing, and you know, seeing what are they saying about me. But my husband, the one who commented about attending the NYTA, so they will come to him like, "Hi, doctor," but he's not a doctor.
He's a man. That's my husband.
So yes. So. So basically, it was so tough. I even had to put a picture of me in my graduation gown. Oh. So when they say, "Are you the doctor?" I'm like, "Yeah, that's me." But returning 4 years this year, it's been a wonderful journey, and we've empowered a lot of school children. We've empowered our community. We've made a difference in many lives. I saw it that I'm just only starting a business. But little did I know that this was a calling. Mm-hmm. And when God calls you and puts you in a place, He will use everything that you have, you know, to anoint you to be the person that, you know, you were called to be. Yeah. And I went there, and, you know, little did I know, as I'm doing consultations, I'm counseling patients. And, you know, you give them hope. When they come to the surgery, a lot of people, Lorraine is my receptionist.
Yes.
So, even to herself, she said, when she's leaving home, you know, you're sad, you are angry. But the moment you step in the surgery, there's this spirit is like, you just light up. Hmm. Even if you came, you had a bed and you were not happy, you were angry, you were sick. A lot of people, when they come in, they're not. You can even see, they will tell you that they came, they were not even walking properly. When they are getting out, the person who came in a wheelchair is working. Where's the pain? I don't know. What did the doctor do? Like, I don't know. That is the anointing that comes with the calling. I always say, it's not me who's doing the treatment. It's God who orders my steps. Sometimes I don't even do much. But just by talking, by the time I give medication, it's like the person is already smiling and said, "Dr. Nambi, I'm healed, I'm fine." And that's the testimony we are seeing. Families, patients are coming, their marriages are almost breaking. When we speak life into their marriage, they come back after, you know, 1-2 years. "Dr. Nambi, thank you for your encouragement. Now I'm back with my husband. My children are doing very well. My children are off the nyaupe because you kept on telling me, don't give up. You know, hold on. And, you know, keep on praying, keep on believing. My business is doing very well because you motivated me. You gave me the inspiration." So those are the things that the practice has been able to bless us with. We're doing motivational talks, we're doing inspirational talks, we go to schools, a lot of kids, we've helped them. I think we've got plus or minus 10 children or learners that were able to enroll into medicine just by last year alone. So that is a good program. And then not only that, so when I started the business, I thought, okay, open the business and then that's it, I'm done, and you know, retire, and that's it. But like I say, when God calls you, you actually don't know, you know, where you are going. But in that process, that's when we released my book, From Ghetto to Doctorpreneur. Because my journey didn't start as lavish as I'm telling you. My journey started in the ghetto. I think if you can see this house, our house was even worse than this.
Okay.
And that's where I was raised. That's the type of house I grew in. There's no drinking water, there's no electricity. We were raised by my grandmother because my mom passed away when I was 9 years old. So on that, that's where the dream realized. I believed when I was still young, maybe one day I can make a difference. As tough as it was, I didn't have the resources. My grandmother could not even afford to take me to school, but I went to school. I was on Kindle studying, and I say, maybe if I work hard, I'll be the hope to my family.
Amen.
If I forget about boyfriends, maybe I'll be the hope to my family. Next, if I forget about partying, I'll be the hope to my family. So I had to leave everything and concentrate on my journey. It was tough. I did not even have money. And I remember I applied to the best high school where I come from. And arriving there, it's rich kids everywhere. And you come in with a plastic bag of your clothes. That's how bad it was. I could not even afford a suitcase. Plastic bag of my luggage. Sandals. And I'm coming and I'm happy. Until I look around. And I'm seeing suitcases. I'm seeing people being driven in with these expensive cars. But what do I do? I remember where I come from. There's a grandma who's living in a small house. Very small. There's no water, there's no electricity. Must I go and give pressure to grandma? I say, grandma, the people at the school are coming with suitcases. They are wearing very nice, expensive shoes. No, I will not put her on pressure. When I get the chance, I will go to the kitchen people and I will tell them, I'm willing to work. If you can give me the breadcrumbs, I'll be able to work, and then you give me the leftovers and juice. That was my food. That's how tough it was. But I didn't give up. Amen. I will study.
Amen.
When I'm studying, I make sure I'm in the top three. I didn't have money to pay for my school fees, but I got someone because they saw my heart. They saw how well I was doing. And then a missionary came. And then they say, no, I'm going to sponsor this child. And that's how I made it. And I finished, and then I enrolled, and I did medicine, and I actually came to South Africa, and that's where I did my career in medicine. And I did my course at University of Pretoria. And during my first year, that's when I met my husband, and we got married. I was still a student. I was in my when we got married, I was still in my third year. But you know, also, yeah, when God just ordains your path, and you know, so I just say, you know what, this is the man, and I'm not going anywhere. So we got married, and then. Yeah, today we are blessed, we have children, and our lives are blessed also. Yeah, so basically, that's short about my story. Today, like I said, I'm running my surgery. I run St. Vincent Hospital, if you know St. Vincent Hospital. The emergency unit is on by me. And I still do work in the government. I'm working also at FH Odendal. I have a salon.
Hair salon.
So if you see hair teas and all this, because of the hair business and the hair salon thing that we are doing. And then I wrote a book. I've spoken about the book that I wrote. And we have a security company. So there's a lot of things. This is just to show you that it doesn't matter where you come from. It doesn't matter your circumstances. It doesn't matter how you were born. All that matters is your own. If you're willing to work hard, if you're willing to give up all this gratification that you want from now, and look on the vision, long term, what is it I can be able to do all these things and still be successful, still get the time to come and motivate and inspire you. What is stopping you? Like I said, I didn't come from a rich family. My upbringing was like that back house that I spoke about. So I didn't have much. I didn't have water. I didn't have electricity in that house. All I had was the hope, the faith, and the belief that God will take me where He wants me to be. So today, as you're sitting here, it's just to encourage you and to motivate you that you know what, as the youth, don't let anybody limit you. I've been told many times, when I was growing up, I've been told I'll never be anything in my life. I was told because I come from the poor background, I'll never even make it as a doctor. But I say it's fine. That is your belief. I believe I can do it. It doesn't matter what is your opinion. If I believe in myself, I know anything is possible because I have the greater one who lives in me. If He lives in me, there's nothing, absolutely nothing that you can tell me that I don't want to do. And that's the power that I walk with me every day. When I see challenges, I say, you know what? This is just nothing because I know God has already given me the power. He has already given me the strength to overcome whatever situation that is standing in my path. So what can men do to me? Nothing. You can come and shout at me. You can come and scream at me. As long as you cannot touch my soul, I'm fine. Yeah. And I still stand up strong. So that's the spirit that I have in me that I'm, you know, I cannot easily be broken down. And the same with you. Don't waste your time watching the soapies. Hey, soapies, make time count because every moment you are being reminded. Today you might be the youth. Today you might be young. Let's talk 5 years down the line. You don't qualify anymore for NYDA. And what did you do with your time? These are opportunities that are being handed to you on a silver plate. What do you do with those opportunities? So embrace that challenge. Take opportunity. Like I said, when I started my business, I went with a loan from African Bank. 3 months down the line, they almost took our house. They almost took the car. Everything I knew was actually almost gone. But I said, I don't care. They can take the house, they can take the car, but I'm not going to give up.
Yeah.
3-4 months down the line, the business picked up and we're able to get back on track on our business. Now imagine, if I gave up, will this book come? No. Will I be running casualty at St. Vincent? No. Will I be in a job there in Effigy on and on or creating other streams of income? No. I won't be able to. So by you not giving up, by you working hard, like as I'm talking now, the editor, like now from here, I have to go and attend, there's a family celebration. Then I'm going to go and attend the celebration. From there, I need to prepare myself for tomorrow because I'm working tomorrow. So there's no rest time for me because I say, if I slumber, if I sleep, opportunities are passing by.
Yes.
And I will look for someone who is awake.
Yes.
Are you awake enough for your opportunities? So this is the chance that you have, the youth. We are here to empower you. We are here to make a difference in your life. Me and my husband, like my husband said already, you know, there's a lot of youth that come to us. We might not have the money, we might not have the resources or whatever, but we will guide you. We will work hand in hand with you. We have those learners that I told you about that now they are involved in, you know, universities, they are doing medicine and all these other courses. Some of them, they don't even have internet. But they came and they said, Mr. Nambi, I don't have internet. Can you help? We have internet at the surgery. We help them. Some didn't have application form fees. We said, no problem. We will swipe it on our card because we see you want it. The more you wipe it, we are going also to help you because we see the need. We see that this one is very handy. There are some who came to Mr. Nambi and said, Mr. Nambi, my parents don't have a car. I need to go, if you can drop me in Pretoria to go to university. We send them to university. We drive them, we drop them. Some they will call you, I don't have to, money for accommodation, but my application is here. And I've been successfully admitted. My room number is here. Like I said, you might not have enough. Even if it's 1,000, 2,000, you say, here is the money, go to your school. At least you have something to keep you until you can be able to get some financial relief. You are making a difference. And that's why we are here. Every one of us. Like I said, if I give up, today my grandmother will still be in that back room house.
Yeah.
But now she has a three-bedroom, big house, there's water, there's electricity. The ghetto child didn't give up.
Yeah.
You see now?
Yeah.
It's the same. You might be the hope of your family. You might be the end of poverty in your family. If you sleep, and when they're telling you, go and study. No, but mama doesn't understand. Go and read. No, mama doesn't understand. But you don't know that if today you don't work hard, you are actually closing the blessing in your family. And the poverty continues. You are not breaking that chain of poverty because you refuse to look into yourself and say, what if God is using me? What if God is using me, like Joseph, to be a blessing in my family? Yeah. But you're refusing. You see now. So the more you continue, the more you will be in the dry season. And your family also will be in the dry season because you refuse to answer to your calling. So as you go home today, begin to reflect, what is my calling? What is God's calling on my life? What is my purpose? Am I doing enough to be in that purpose? The other day I was just driving the car and I went to Nando's and I wanted to buy some lunch. And I was so happy because we're doing a motivational seminar and everything is, it's like working out, and I was so happy. And then and I just came and I was driving the Audi. So when I came at the parking, I even forgot to put the handbrake on. It's just a button you press, you know. But I forgot to put it on. And I was wearing heels. I decided, you know what, let me change. And then in that process of, I thought I parked the car, and then my leg was still on the accelerator.
Oh, sorry.
And then I just went to reach out for my sandals. The next thing, this leg is pressing hard, and the car went and hit one of the poles there in front of Nando's. And the car got cracked. But it was a reality check. Life is too short. Life is too short. Today you might think, oh, I still have 5 years. I still have 20 years. That was a reality check for me, that I could have died at that moment. If I died in that moment, did I mean anything? What I'm standing for, did it mean anything? The messages I'm sending out, did it mean anything? Did it change someone's life? Did I bring someone closer to God? Or did I bring them even further away from God? And then as I went back, it was like, instead of being sad, I'm like, you know, thank God for the realization that life is too short. As we're standing here, as we're sitting here today, all of us, we are not even guaranteed tomorrow. The rest of the afternoon, we are not guaranteed. What are you making of this hour, this second, this minute that you've been given? How many lives are you changing? How many lives are you impacting? You don't have to be a Dr. Nambi to change a life. They might be like here in church. They just need probably somebody to say, you know what, I don't mind. I'm going to leave home early. I'm going to come and clean the church. That's all it needs. Or that maybe you don't have the time to clean the church, but you'll be, you know, I might have from my business, extra 500. This month, for extra 500, I'm going to give to the church so that they can buy extra chairs, buy extra clothes, buy tea. Mm-hmm. They offered us tea. Where does the money for tea come from? Yeah. Nice biscuits, the lunch they are preparing. Those are things that, you know what, it will mess up when one day you are no more. They will say, you know what, because of that lady, that day we had coffee, that day we had tea, we had a nice lunch. That's what life is all about. The impact, the lives that you are changing. So while we still have the opportunity, let's use it, let's make a difference in our communities, let's make a difference in our houses, in our children's lives, our families. The other day, I went home and we had issues in the family. And I told my husband, when I was driving home, I was actually very sad. And then I kept on praying and I told myself, you know, what is your purpose, God? I'm coming from South Africa and I'm driving to Namibia. And on the way, I'm being told, you know what, there's a big family crisis and we don't even think your fathers are going to speak, because I have a biological father and also my uncle. So my two fathers are fighting each other. And the reason they are fighting is because of me. Oh, and I was not so happy. So I told myself, you know, God, why is this happening now? This is supposed to be a happy moment. But I asked myself, but why is the purpose that you allow this to happen now while I'm on my way? And when I arrived at home, I said, you know what? I went, I called the big papa, I went, I called the small papa, we are going to sit today. And we spoke for almost 3 hours in a family meeting, to the point that we started, okay, forgive, 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 forgive. And then after 2 days, we did the unveiling of my mother, my late mother, my grandfather, and the other uncles who passed away. And through that, we were also able to bless my father with a brand a car. We got him a bike, so we went to give him. And the fight was, you know, they thought maybe we've forgotten him and all those things. So it was just a blessing. When we were closing, then one of the elders said, you know what? Today, God is using a young child to come and bring peace in our family. Who knew a small child like you will one day sit the fathers and bring peace in the family? Amen. So you see now, your calling is greater. You know, God is just telling you, you know what, you think you're just gonna be here, but I'm going to make you to be the one that will open the way in your family. You understand now? So it's a greater calling that is on your life. And if you don't honor it, it will just be wasted and it will be at the grave. While we have the chance, while we have the time, let's make a difference. Our families, our children, our communities, and let's make this world a better place. When we are walking out, sometimes I don't even have to preach. I don't even preach. What I do is, like I said, my trademark, I just smile. And that peace of God will continue, will overflow. I don't have to tell you and preach to you about Jesus. You see Jesus in me every day. That's how our lives must be. That when you're working, that one is not a normal type of woman. That woman, she is blessed. That woman, she's anointed. And you didn't even open your mouth. So that is all I have for you today. I hope you've been encouraged. I hope you've been blessed. Yeah. And thank you for the opportunity. Yeah. That's all from my side.